Hello, welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc. I'm joined today by Katy Bourne, the Police and Crime Commissioner for Sussex. Katy, welcome to the programme and thank you for joining us.
Great to be here.
A key part of your role is to hold the Chief Constable, Giles York, to account. And you'll be doing that on Wednesday this week, the 16th of December, in a two-hour meeting, which is called the Performance and Accountability Meeting, is that right?
Yeah, snappy title. So,
and it's webcast for those who can't make it along.
It is.
Sadly not on latest TV, but there's a webcast portal. One of the things that I know you want to ask the Chief Constable about is about the government's announcement on how their plans to protect police spending will affect Sussex Police, because you were looking at quite a big chunk of money disappearing, if you like, from your income. That looks like that's not going to happen now. Do you have any idea how he might answer?
Well, I kind of want to get his thoughts around it, because you're absolutely right. Up until last week, we were sort of planning the worst.
Yes.
We'd been told to model the budget to expect to cut anything between 25% and 40%. So it would have been a huge amount.
Yes.
So we'd modelled it on 25%, and that was the whole reason for bringing in, well, one of the many reasons for bringing in the new policing programme, which is looking at remodelling policing across the county. But the announcement last week that there's no cuts to police budgets, so in real terms, was a welcome.
For this year and next?
And as I understand it, until 2020, in the remainder of this government.
From where you sit, reassuring.
Yeah, very reassuring. But as with everything, the devil will be in the detail. So we'll know more about what the finer parts of that mean on Wednesday.
Yes.
When the formula and the police, well, when the final police grant is actually decided and allocated, and we know more what it looks like, but the general, you know, the general terms around that was very welcome to hear. And I have to say, I was in Manchester at the time, and we had a meeting of all the chief constables and all the police and crime commissioners up and down the country, and we were all there sitting around the TV waiting.
Dreading.
Well, yes, I have to be honest. And there we were waiting for the announcement, and we had all the national television cameras trained on us.
Crikey.
And the Chancellor made the announcement that, you know, the police protect us and we will protect the police and there will be no cuts. And nobody said anything. And we all sat there in stunned silence. And I remember turning to one of my colleagues and went, hurrah! And then everyone just sort of erupted after that.
Yeah.
But it was just the initial was stunned. We'd braced ourselves for bad news.
I mean, yours is a sort of political role, if you like. You're elected, but to operate on behalf of the public, holding the police to account. So, politically, you're on the same side as the government. You're both conservative. Yeah, conservative government, conservative police and crime commissioner.
Yes.
You had no inkling this was coming.
No, because I'd been making a lot of representations behind the scenes, because not only were the government looking at cutting our overall grant that we get from government, but they were also looking at changing the formula, which tells us how much money we can get from the grant. And they were doing the two, and we'd had real issues, I certainly had, around the formula grant, because the way they were looking at that formula would have meant that Sussex, potentially, would have been looking at a further cut of up to 8 million annually.
Ouch.
On top of the whatever percentage the government were going to cut. And I have to, you know, give credit to our MPs in Sussex. They were fantastically supportive and went to see the Home Secretary and lobbied on our behalf as well. But so I was really concerned. But then the government had made the announcement that they'd got it wrong with the grant, and actually they were going to hold back on that and review it in conjunction with chiefs and PCCs, which is good news. And then, of course, the announcement about the cuts as well, or no cuts.
So sort of a double whammy in a good way.
A good way, but the other thing to be cautious of is that the Home Secretary I saw on Tuesday, we had another meeting with her and all chiefs and PCCs, and she was under no illusion. She said, you know, don't think you can sit back on your laurels. We will continue as a government with police reform.
Yes.
And so I expect you to continue. And her final words were, it's over to you now. So I think that there's a very much an understanding of, you know, we're protecting your budget, but we expect you to drive out further savings. And I'm quite clear, as is the Chief Constable, we will continue to do that and invest it in front line.
I mean, in the spring this year, you and the Chief Constable together presented, obviously, you're sort of you're anticipating the settlement that the financial settlement you expected, and set out some quite radical changes in a way. And I mean, if I've got this right, the chief is responsible for the sort of the operational policing, if you like, and you kind of challenge him and oversee what's going on.
I do.
So it's not your sort of job to say, actually, Can you set priorities as well, can you?
I set the priorities for policing. Traditionally, they were always set by government.
Yes.
And then they would be delivered locally by the chief constable.
Right.
So you had national priorities set by government, delivered locally. Now, they're local priorities. They're set through me as a local politician. But they have to reflect what local Sussex residents feel is it should be a priority in policing. So for the first time ever, local people have a direct say in the priorities for policing their county. I get lobbied a lot. I mean, I'm out and about all the time talking to the public and feeling the temperature and understanding what it is that's important to them. There are key areas that they were very clear about when I came into office, you know, domestic abuse. Mm-hmm. They wanted to see the police continuing their work on domestic abuse and improving that police response. Road safety, that continues to be probably the biggest post bag that I receive. People in Sussex get very exercised about the roads. So I get to write the strategy now, the police and crime plan, as it's called, that sets the strategy for policing. So it's no longer set by government. So our plan is very, very local to what people in Sussex want.
And with things like domestic abuse and domestic violence, I mean, we this time of year, we're coming up to Christmas. Sussex Police has just started sort of, I don't know what the right word is, sort of launched its sort of
new operation.
Yes. Thank you. And with a new name. That's all about, again, I think, years ago, domestic abuse cases were kind of treated as sort of, it's behind closed doors, it's not our issue. But now the police are very much part of the sort of family of public services trying to help deal with these issues and protect the vulnerable.
Yeah, I mean, it was a key priority area, domestic abuse, and getting people, first of all, to come forward and report it, because you're right,
it happens. Historically, hasn't been historically something the police take terribly seriously. I don't mean that as a criticism, it's just
it was a case. I mean, the HMIC, the inspectorate that go in and inspect police forces nationally, did a report 2 years ago looking at domestic abuse, and they called it everybody's responsibility, the report. Yeah. And it was fairly damning for all police forces up and down the country, including Sussex. They were not in a good place when it came to helping people and supporting victims, getting them to the courts, getting them through. There's been a lot of work in police forces, and particularly in Sussex, and I've been at the forefront of a lot of that as well. You know, Sussex Police became the first police force in England and Wales to get white ribbon status. Oh, good, I'm wearing it. No, just checking there. Which shows their commitment to stamping out domestic abuse. I sit on the National Domestic Abuse Oversight Group, which is personally chaired by the Home Secretary as well. Done an awful lot of work around domestic abuse in Sussex, and also working with partners, because it can't be something that's delivered on its own.
No.
You know, but the police response is far superior to how it has been.
I mean, what's been really interesting to see as well is I mean, I guess there are like there's fashions in clothing and et cetera, there are in sort of even in things like policing in a way, I guess, because you've seen people coming up through the ranks and now taking senior positions, like, for example, Nev Kemp here in Brighton and Hove, who has been one of the officers, one of the senior officers who seems to me a few years ago recognised that protecting vulnerable people like that.
Really important.
And his predecessor, Graham Bartlett, too. And it's almost as though they've been slightly ahead of the curve with something like this.
Well, Sussex Police, I mean, traditionally was always very good at responding to domestic abuse incidents, but you can always be better. And certainly there's been a huge drive on that, and of course a lot of pressure from government now, especially since the inspectorate review around this. So I'm really pleased where Sussex are, and there's a new report coming out in the new year that HMIC, the inspectorate, have done, looking at vulnerability. And whilst we won't know what the report says until the new year, all the indications are showing that Sussex Police will be in a very strong position when that report comes out.
That's good to hear.
And well, it's good for victims of this, you know, because if the statistics tell us, you know, one in four women at some stage in their lives are a victim of domestic abuse.
Well,
it can take many
number.
Forms.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily just violence. Violence can often be the end product.
Hmm.
So it starts with that coercive, controlling behaviour.
Yeah.
I don't know, are you an Archers fan?
Yes, I am.
You are, brilliant. Well, there's a great piece on there at the moment with Helen and Rob, where he's just manoeuvring her into the, and you can see the signs happening, where he's questioning her and she's beginning to question her own reasons why she does stuff. He's undermining her confidence. Yeah. And then the next thing you'll see, it will progress from there. This can go on over a long period of time, many, many years. And often the victim doesn't even know that she's a victim. Now, I don't want everyone to write into your show and say, well, she didn't mention the men. Men can be victims of domestic abuse as well. And actually, when they are, I would argue, it's as bad, if not worse. Because for a man to be beaten by a woman, a lot of heterosexual men still seem to snigger about that and see it as
even
a bit of a joke.
There's a culture of course, you might take it, but you don't want to hit a woman kind of thing. There's a
precisely
often brought up.
Yeah, you know. There's a lot of cultural difficulties to climb through. Mm. But the majority of victims tend to be women, and so you know, I've made it my mission.
And we're looking at this time of year because it's Christmas, of course, when it sometimes seems to peak.
Well, the police are really interesting. They're going out on special patrols and actually knocking on doors of known perpetrators and telling them to stop it.
Well, that's a proactive approach. We're going to take a short break for the ads, but please don't go away, and please join us again in just a few moments after this short break. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and Katy Bourne, the Sussex Police and Crime Commissioner. Katy, we were talking about the performance and accountability meeting with the Chief Constable before
yes.
the break.
Which are webcast live and archived for everyone to watch.
Fantastic. And that's on sussex-pcc.gov.uk. Thank you, website.
Just use that well-known search engine to find me.
Well, it's not. I was going to say, you can only put your name in, actually, yeah. to find you online yeah. very easily, I'd
yeah.
say. So, which is probably a good sign, I suspect. One of the things you're going to ask about on Wednesday at this meeting is what's called Operation Dragonfly. This
yes.
is the annual.
Yes.
Again,
oh,
we
yes.
were talking about domestic violence crackdown at Christmas and etc. But this is another annual or twice a year sort of campaign to really focus on this area. You mentioned road safety is something that people contact
yeah.
you about.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can run me through the basics of this campaign.
Well, it's proactive. It's Christmas. People drink and increasingly take drugs. And so it's a real crackdown on anybody that drinks and drugs while they're driving.
It's easier to detect people who've taken drugs now compared with the past, and in a way that's structured and...
Yes, they have roadside tests, and so the police are very proactive around this, and they're also tweeting as well, live, to give the public information about where they've stopped people, what areas and so on, and how many they've charged. And then as soon as they've charged people, the other thing that Sussex are doing, which is really unusual, is they're actually printing and publishing people's names online, so that if you think you can drink on a Saturday night and get away with it,
yes.
and the police catch you Monday morning at work, people will know that you were caught.
Stopped.
Yes.
Yeah. And it is the people. It's not the people they've stopped. It's the people they've charged. So
yes.
It's
yes.
The point.
I mean, it's always been in the public domain. As
yes.
soon as you're charged,
but
your name.
They've been a bit more systematic about making sure that.
Well, they're
out
using
there.
Social media now more effectively, and of course we know how quick that happens. So whereas before they might pin your name up on a piece of paper outside the courthouse,
yes.
A few people might have seen it.
Yeah.
Now everybody sees it. So.
Okay. And I mean, if I can sustain the social media theme for a second, while we're recording this, there is for the first time a disciplinary hearing in Sussex taking place in public for an inspector. I mean, social media and using email and things like that are part of what form the complaint that he's answering today.
Mm.
I appreciate you probably can't go into the detail of that case, particularly as we talk, it hasn't been decided. But I guess what I wanted to sort of work out is why are they now being held in public when they've always previously not been?
I think this is a drive to make these sort of affairs more transparent to the public, because there's been a lot of worry from the public and lack of confidence that how can the police inspect themselves? And you know, they are held in very high regard by the public. They have very unusual positions of power
yes.
over us as individuals.
Yeah.
And therefore, we should expect the highest levels of behaviour from them. And so I think there was a feeling that if these sort of events took place behind closed doors, how do we know that they're properly reprimanded? How do we know these things happen
yes.
Correctly? Whilst the police will tell you that they do, there's always a little element. We're all always a bit distrustful. Now, of course, it's out in the public domain. You can attend. Any member of the public can, and you can sit there and listen and see it happen for yourself. So it's a real drive for transparency.
I mean, the Police Federation, which is the nearest to a trade union, if you like, that the police have. I mean, there are people in the Federation who have expressed some reservations about this and would say that there are not many. You know, you point out to me a company that would do this, a business that would do this, and I mean.
Well, you're right, and I really understand the feelings of reservations when they came out. There was a lot of worry and concern around it. But at the end of the day, these are only in really gross misconduct cases, so the worst.
The sackable offences,
Yes. And the other part of the law that's changed is that traditionally a police officer, if they were up for gross misconduct, they could retire. Take early retirement and go, and then not
draw their pension,
not be held responsible, not face any recriminations or punishment.
Became quite a trend, didn't it? Actually,
it did, and actually, rightly, the public was saying, well, why should they get away with it? Yeah. So, of course, now they're not allowed to retire or resign or have you, and they have to stay and face that disciplinary procedure, but only for gross misconduct.
Okay.
Of course, the other side of it is that, unfortunately, and a lot of the public don't realise, is because they can't resign, you still have to keep them on the payroll. So you are still actually, they're sitting at home being paid a full salary waiting for this disciplinary committee. So you have to kind of balance.
There's always swings and roundabouts.
There always is.
I mean, they're a lot more professionally run as well under the new regime, aren't they? I mean, I think there are lawyers involved to make sure there's proper due process, if you like. And not that there may not have been due process before, but to remove any suspicion that it's like, the old boys' network or something like that, the canteen culture.
This is it. Traditionally, it would be chaired. The event would be chaired by a senior police officer. Now we have legally independent chairs, and they've been appointed through my office. So the five PCCs in the southern region have got together, and we've appointed a list of about 30 that we can call on, and these are highly qualified. Some of them are Queen's Counsel and so on, and they are independent, legally qualified chairs, and they will bring a huge amount of scrutiny and robustness to the whole procedure.
And I mean, with this sort of run-of-the-mill disciplinary stuff, presumably that crosses your desk anyway. You see, in terms of, you see how many officers have been accused of getting into trouble. I mean, things that are not necessarily breaches of the criminal law, but the high standards we expect of our officers.
I can see them if I choose to, but ultimately the officers, police officers and staff, are the remit of the Chief Constable. So they're his police officers, his staff. And so HR procedures should go through him.
Right.
But what I have the ability to do in my office is to dip sample.
Okay.
So I go into professional standards department as it is, and I ask for certain cases, and I choose what I want to look at, and we will look at them in my office and scrutinise them and see if we're happy with them.
And you presume you can see the trends as well, for example,
if
particular offences are happening, or I say particular offences against their terms and conditions of employment, etc., and the numbers and that kind of thing.
Yes. Oh, so we scrutinise quite heavily. We drill down and on behalf of the public.
And the other thing I wanted to ask you about that I know is sort of on the cards this week, if you like, is you have quite a few PCSOs. One of the things that when we were talking about the budget stuff earlier, that looked like changing is thinking about how you use PCSOs. Mm-hmm. For example, what the balance is between the number of officers. If I said civilian staff, what I mean is non-uniform employees of the police and PCSOs. And what's happening this week? I mean,
the PCSO role hasn't changed for over a decade in Sussex. And post Paris, we need to look at how we're utilising PCSOs in particular in our communities, because they're right on the ground.
Yeah.
They hear information that's vital, particularly around extremism, terrorism and so on. And when you've got a PCSO role that's been sitting there that's policing to a 20th century need, it's not really very relevant. So starting today, PCSOs are in a process of consultation around their roles. That will be finalised in the new year. And then Sussex Police will make a decision on how they're going to upskill them, give them greater responsibilities, give them more skills around this, so that they can keep us all safe. So really important.
And is this, I mean, will this affect the number of PCSO roles there are, either more or fewer?
It may well do. It will undoubtedly see a reduction in PCSOs, because despite the fact that there's no cut to the budget in real terms, it does still mean that we have to find savings and drive reform. And this is all part of it. Neighbourhood policing hadn't been touched for donkey's years.
Yeah.
And we know that the threats of criminality are changing, and there's a lot greater need on policing to change with that. So this is all part of that process. Well, there's more crime online, there's more child abuse, there's the, as I said, post-Paris, where we find ourselves. And I really value PCSOs, and I know the public do, because they tell me all the time. So we're not doing away with PCSOs, they're vital. But what we are saying is, are they actually relevant to today's needs to keep us safe in our communities?
Are they used in the best way that they can be?
Precisely.
And you were saying post-Paris, I mean, obviously, we have issues even in Brighton and Hove. We've, at least three people from Brighton, young people from Brighton, have died in Syria or in that part of the world in fighting. So although we're, you know, perhaps, you know, not like Birmingham or Bradford, etc., but we're not without, we're not unaffected by, by this environment too. We've got Gatwick on our doorstep.
Yes.
And there have been concerns expressed, like, even over the weekend, about whether the border police, as it were, might be withdrawing too much from our seaports. And again, we have harbour and a couple of harbours nearby, very close to our hearts here.
Well, and I was quite vocal in that as well. So, no, you're absolutely right. This is all part of it. This is what the local policing programme is looking at. It's actually saying, do we have a policing model that is fit for the 21st century? And I understand that, you know, PCSOs are going to be concerned about their roles, rightly so, which is why they're entering into a very long sort of consultation process with the force. And
Are they represented by the Police Federation as well?
No, they're represented by Unison.
Okay.
So they come under police staff.
Yeah.
So Unison represents all the police staff. The Police Federation represent the officers, and then you have the Superintendents Association who represent the superintendents. Yeah. Surprise, surprise.
And then as it were, used to be called ACPO for the
Well,
for
it's the NPCC ranks, now, the National Police Chiefs Council now.
Well, so I'm going to say, just one last thing. When are you up for re-election?
May the 5th next year.
Yes. So not long to go.
Yeah, thanks for that.
Sorry.
So I know.
Probably could have phrased that better.
It's been 3 years, so it would have been 3.5 years. I mean, it's meant to be a 4-year term, but the initial election was late and so on.
Well,
and yes, I will stand again as the Conservative.
Well, I'm sure we'll speak to you before then. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
Please watch again very soon. Goodbye for now.